before meltdowns and not behaving what tantrums are. A tantrum is a behaviour, it's a response to them not getting their own way about something or not getting something they want. Meltdown is not behavioural. I know Sandra will back me up in saying that. There is nothing behavioural about it. They are not being naughty when they're having a meltdown. The worst thing you can do is punish them. I can guarantee, unless you want that meltdown to last for 3 hours, and I've had that, do not punish them, because punishing them is going to result in much worse meltdown and 3 hours of them screaming and kicking. So absolutely, do not punish them. So if a child is having a tantrum, they will be looking for your reaction. They'll be looking to see if they're about to get the thing that they're tantruming over. So if they're aware of your reaction and they're looking to see how you're reacting, chances are it's a tantrum. If they're mid-meltdown, they're not looking for your reaction. Because the only thing that they're thinking about is what's going on up here and how to stop it. They're not really thinking at all. They'll have no care for personal safety, so you might sometimes hear of children banging their heads, hurting themselves, another sure sign is a meltdown. Children who are with it and having a tantrum aren't going to hurt themselves. The other thing is hurting others. So I remember when my son was quite young and his younger brother was a baby, and he had this meltdown, and the nearest thing to him at the time, which was here, was a book, a heavy one. And he picked it up and he launched it and it hit his baby brother. Now that was a clear sign that he was having a meltdown, not a tantrum. Because a tantrum, because he adored his brother. He was only one at the time, the little one. And he adored it, never hurt him. And after he'd come out of the meltdown, he was devastated, absolutely heartbroken that he'd hurt his brother. He hadn't done any damage, but he could have done, and he was devastated. So that's a surefire sign that it's a meltdown, because they'll hurt themselves or they'll hurt someone that they would never want to hurt normally. And as I've said a million times, and I'll keep saying it, disciplining it will make it worse. Disciplining a meltdown will just make it worse, and it will not ever stop it from happening again, because they have no control over it.
So when we started school the very first day, I was quite surprised when the education department in New Wisdom had not seen fit to allocate any funding for my son to receive an aid. They said that he didn't qualify because it was ADHD, and he said he didn't qualify because his behaviour problems weren't severe enough. And we put in an appeal, and the appeal was met with the allocation of funding for 2 hours a day. And because there'd been a couple of times when I couldn't stay, and the teacher had ended up chasing him around the streets of Montmorency, the school deemed that he was not safe to stay without supervision and that I was to pick him up every day at 12 o'clock. So I did that for the first term and I did it for second term. And in between, I wrote to all of the various departments within the education department. I tried to find out who was responsible for funding, and I went and visited our former local member, Steve Herbert, several times and spoke with his staff. All of the time, each time they were very sympathetic, but they never did anything about it. So coming home one day at 12 o'clock, I pulled into Steve Herbert's office. He wasn't there, but his staff were there. And I said, my son has to leave school every day at 12 o'clock. So every day from now on, I'm going to just sit here with him until 3:30. And I didn't give him his 12 o'clock Ritalin. I decided that they should see what it's like with him raw. And he got in there and he ran around because they had a bag of toys at the up end of those pretty quick. And normally I'm pretty you know, strict and grab him and try and control him and try and helicopter him. Shh, I normally say. This time I just let him rip. And he stood on the table and he jumped off and he said, "Mom, I'm gonna see how far I can jump." So he kept jumping further and further and further each time. And then he noticed that there was a little gate into the actual office section, and he went in there and he interrogated everyone. "What are you doing? What's your name? Why are you here? Who are you talking to on the phone? Is that your computer? Can I do that? Can I touch that, please? Oh, what's in this drawer?" At a million miles an hour. And I just sat there quietly, and I'd go, "Blake, come on, back you come." And he'd come back and he'd go, "Oh, Mum, that lady over there is talking to someone on the phone, and that lady over there's got a red ball on her desk. Can I go and get it?" "Sure." assistants came up and said, oh, you don't really need to stay. I said, yes, I do, because I can't take him to school. He can't stay at school. It's discrimination. So anyway, here we were at the local Member of Parliament's office, who happened to be the Secretary for the Department of Education. And they were telling me that they couldn't do anything. I just said, well, that's okay. We'll just be here every day until I get the funding. Anyway, after an hour, I noticed there was a bit of movement in the station. Several of the staff went into a room, and Blake started banging on the door, going, you play hide and seek! Can I play too? And 20 minutes later, one of them came out to me and said, look, as a special favour, the minister has decided to allocate some special funding to you. So 90 minutes of being subjected to my son, turn them. After all of those phone calls, after all of those letters, after all of those emails, after everything else, it was only using my son as a weapon of mass destruction that actually worked. But then they said to me, oh, we'll be available for next term. And we still had another 3 weeks of funding to go, of term to go. So I said, oh, that's okay. I'll just be here every day for the next 3 weeks. Oh, hold on a moment. I'll go and make some phone calls. Meanwhile, Blake was still trying to see how far he could jump off their table and how far he could throw the ball in the office without hitting people. Anyway, 20 minutes later she came back and I had funding for the very next day. So, if you do need to get funding, don't ever give up.
You guys may have heard I'm training for Ninja Warrior, so that's a physically grueling course. I, in my head, have already looked at the tapes and gone, I'm stuffed. I'm really stuffed. But, you know what? I'll train as bloody hard as I can to get this body and this mind mentally ready, so that if I'm accepted on national television for season 2 of Ninja Warrior and I'm standing there ready to do this course, I'll bloody well do it. And I will bloody well represent the community of Autism Asperger's. That good hard training and determination and a positive mindset might get me through the first stage of this event. No one's won it, but hey, it's about the fact that get the confidence, get them feeling more positive within themselves, that they can go and do anything in life. They want to drive a car, they can drive a car. They want to go and one day rent with friends or whatever in a house, they can do that.
Central auditory processing disorder, sometimes called auditory processing, CAPD, PD, it's all the same thing. It's all basically a term that is an umbrella term, refers to a person who has normal hearing, but for some reason their brain is not able to make sense of what they hear. So what are the indicators that a child may have a central auditory processing disorder? The list is long. These children often don't pay attention in class. They sometimes are disruptive and get in trouble for talking to their classmates. Their behaviour is sometimes labelled as being disruptive. They also can be withdrawn and non-disruptive and not have any behavioural problems and almost fly under the radar. So you can have, it can be a range of presentations. They seem to not follow instructions well. I remember with my son, the teacher would also say that he had trouble initiating tasks. So the instructions would be to the class and all the other kids that stop the instructions, off they go and they'd start working. And my son, 10 minutes later, would be looking around the room. So they're often trouble initiating tasks. They appear to be disorganised. Disorganised with their work, disorganised with their thoughts, disorganised with their personal belongings. They lose everything. I can't tell you the number of things that I've lost of my sons. It's all part of the same thing. They're very forgetful, so if you ask them to do 3 things, then one thing will get done, and then I remember with my son, even just the simple routine of getting ready in the day. This is, look, my son's been at school for a few years, and as you know, you get up, you get dressed, you brush your teeth, These are things you do every single day, buddy. Why can't we get this happening? Why do we? And I would be saying to you, mate, I want you to go to the bathroom, brush your teeth, do your hair, and then put your jumper on. And then I'd see him walking the other way. I'd say, buddy, the bathroom's that way. And it's really frustrating. And I love that child. But, you know, he goes to school, the teachers, as wonderful as they are, they don't necessarily love your child. So certainly, it must be frustrating for them to manage a child who seems to need a special invitation just to get through what should be routine, predictable, and move slowly. I mean, move, you know, relatively smoothly. They seem to do worse when it's noisy. Academic progress is often slipping. They're not making the gains, and they're not at the level that they would be expected of them in a certain amount of time or given their year level. Parents are confused and upset. Often they'll come to us and say, everyone's saying this kid's had a hearing loss, but I've had a hearing test. Their hearing's fine. And what can happen is if we don't flag this early on, parents will go off on a tangent trying to find out what the issue would be, and it could be, and if you look at this list, there's a lot of conditions that probably you've talked about in this conference that would fall under this presentation. So you can go off on a tangent looking into something where the remediation is potentially not appropriate. The child themselves might say that they can't hear the teacher. They may say that it sounds like everyone's talking at once. The greatest difficulties seem to be listening under adverse conditions such as noise, background noise, like a classroom, and reverberation. I know reverberation can be a significant problem. I know with my son, swimming lessons, the pool is such a reverberant surface, like this room where it's a big, sound is bouncing off the walls and getting distorted. I remember my son, when they were naughty or played up and didn't listen, they'd be sat on the side of the pool. I remember the frustration of watching and paying for my child to sit at the edge of the pool because he was labelled as having a behavioural problem or listening to the 15-year-old youth that was taking the lesson for that week, which is probably different from the one that would take it the next week. So even though you're explaining the same thing again, you've got to do this and you've got to do this. So in the end, he hated swimming. We pulled him out. We didn't do it anymore because it was all just too hard for us. And, we worked on other things.
So see the child, not the behaviour. Don't punish or discipline the behaviour that's coming from an area of anxiety. That is the worst thing you can do. Imagine feeling anxious and that your world is falling apart and now you're being punished because the way you're displaying that anxiety isn't normal or considered socially acceptable. Okay? Awful. Can do awful things to someone's self-esteem. Don't use negative language or take away privileges or make threats. This will increase the child's anxiety for the same reasons. Imagine feeling anxious and your world's falling apart and then, you're getting all this negative talk put at you, yeah? Power struggles are not helpful either. This is where my son comes in. It's easy to get drawn into power struggles with him, but careful use of language, you can just diffuse power struggles straight away. It's like, saying, that is a great idea and I think we could do that, but we're not going to do that now. So I've said no to him, but I haven't said no. He hasn't heard no. He's heard later, cool. With a bit of luck, he forgets about it or not. but we eventually get there. But that's just an example of learning to say no in a different way than actually say no that can diffuse situations. And this can seem obvious, but in the moment of sheer frustration on your part as a parent, carer or a teacher, it can be very, very hard to do. But ask the child if there's something bothering them, but not in the throes of a meltdown. That's not the time to do it. Let them calm down first. So choose the timing. Kindness and reassurance. Show caring and understanding. Encourage the child to talk. Acknowledge their feelings. Check in with the person, ask if they're okay, and no judgment. Encourage the child to take slow, deep breaths, which came up earlier, and practice together. This is something you can do at home as a parent. And I encourage you to practice these things at home in a safe environment. And then once you're ready, take them to the school and educate the teachers. So this is what we've been doing at home when this happens. So, if we can try it at school, this may help. But practice it and do these things at home and perfect them at home first. Make time to worry. So, you know, the cliche, problem shared is a problem solved. This is the same with anxiety. Encourage them to talk and deal with the worries and normalise their feelings and normalise situations. So, you know, bring the catastrophizing down and things like that. And bring down worries into manageable chunks. So set mini goals. It's like if school refusal, okay, just go to school today. We're not going to worry about the rest of the week, the rest of the term, or the rest of the year. We're just going to go to school today. That's it. Done. Can you go to school today? So just aim on more in the moment. Encourage positive and rational thinking. Again, that's all about the catastrophizing and the like. Have a go and emphasize trying things and emphasize that it's okay to not be perfect and not to get everything right, which is a common ASD trait, the perfectionism and things like that. It's okay, it doesn't matter. You don't have to get everything right. It's okay to make mistakes.